us as we go through your word, that you would just minister to our hearts those things that we need to have, the things that we need to see, and the attitudes, the adjustments, the corrections that we need to put into our lives, Lord, that you would just be faithful to show them to us so that we might be then faithful to allow you to do that work, Lord. So have your way with us, we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Mark chapter 13, we got partway through the last time. This Olivet Discourse, as they've named it, because he was at the Mount of Olives. So this talk at Mount Olivet becomes the Olivet Discourse. And remember, it all came about because the disciples came out and asked Jesus if he saw what manner of stones in the buildings and how good they looked and how great they were. And he answered them, and he answered them about things that were going to be taken down, torn apart, disassembled before them. Certainly during that time when the Romans would come through in 70 AD, but also for the last times, speaking of the tribulation period that would come. And we got through the first part of the tribulation period down to verse 13. And then it talks about the Great Tribulation. It isn't that it was any worse than the first part. Certainly the judgments were intensified, but it was a greater tribulation because of the Antichrist movements. Because remember, this whole thing has been set up because of the agreement between the Antichrist and Israel and the rest of the world. Once that peace treaty had been signed, then the tribulation period had started. And in that time, all these things have gone on. And now we're in the midst of the tribulation period in verse 14. And it says, "But when you shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel, the prophet, standing where it ought not be, let him that readeth understand. And then let them that be in Judea flee to the mountains." And it does a few things for us. Certainly Daniel's a great commentary on this section here. In Daniel chapter 9, in chapter 11, 12, they all deal with these things that are going to be going on. But in chapter 9, verse 27, it says this, "And he," speaking of the Antichrist, the beast, "he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week," just speaking of that time period of the tribulation, the 7 days, the 7 year period. "And in the midst of the week, he shall cause the sacrifice and the oblation to cease, and for the overspreading of abominations." I love how he puts that, the overspreading. It's just going to be completely engulfing the world. The overspreading of abominations. We kind of see them now. We're just getting a foreshadow of what's going to come to pass. Can you imagine? It's this bad now. What's it going to be when all hell is poured out? It's just going to be awful. "The overspreading of abominations. He shall make it desolate even until the consummation, and that determined shall be poured out upon the desolate." So this is... not only does he say in Mark here the abomination of desolation, but even in Daniel, it's determined, it says in that verse, that it's going to be poured out upon those that are desolate, those that are without hope, those that have no hope, no future, no relationship with the Lord. These things are going to be poured out. There's an interesting verse in Lamentations 2 in chapter 1, if you're taking notes and just want to put it in the side light and take a look at it later. Chapter 1, verse 10, it says this, "The adversary hath spread out his hand upon all her pleasant things," speaking of the things of Israel, "for she hath seen that the heathen have entered into her sanctuary," the Antichrist entering into the sanctuary in this middle part of this 7 year period when the Antichrist goes in. Remember, he's rebuilt the temple, It's a false temple. It's going to be torn down. Jesus is going to build the real one. But it's there. He has this peace treaty with Israel. They're doing sacrifices. They're doing all those things. In the middle part of the tribulation period, 3.5 years in, after the 144,000 have witnessed, and the two witnesses are there, and they've taken their place in history, that he's going to go in and then proclaim himself to be God. Just what he's always wanted, but could never have, and he's still never going to have it. But he, for some reason, thinks that he can do it. But it says, the adversary has spread out his hand upon all her pleasant things, for she has seen that the heathen have entered into her sanctuary when thou didst command that they should not enter into thy congregation. They shouldn't have entered in. And yet he entered in. Israel, in signing this agreement, allowed him to be there. And he goes into the temple, goes in and sits on the throne and proclaims himself to be God and demands to be worshipped. And that's when God pours out all his wrath. In these last judgments that are poured out, the vials, the bowls, are going to be intensified over the other ones that have already been through, the trumpet judgments and all those. And it's just so awful. But the abomination of desolation, the abomination of it, just the awfulness of it, and it's going to be desolate because there's no hope in it. There's no fruit from it. It's just completely desolate. It's empty, and there's no fulfillment of anything good. So it's spoken by Daniel, standing where he ought not to be standing. And then he tells the people, he tells the Jews, let them that are in Judea flee to the mountains, get out of town. It's time to take whatever you have and flee. And he intensifies it, and he says in verse 15, and let him that is on the housetop not go down into the house, neither enter therein to take anything out of the house. Don't even bother going down off the roof into your house. Just get off the roof and run. Take what you have on and just run, because that's all you're going to be able to take. If you take any extra time, you're going to be consumed, because the enemy's going to pour out his wrath upon God's people because of their running away, because of what God is doing. And if you're a straggler, if you've taken time to go back and grab a hold of something that you think is valuable besides your life, you're going to end up losing your life. And so he says, get out of here. Can you imagine the disciples? They're coming down out of Jerusalem. They see this wonderful temple that Herod has built. He built it to make it last. It was a great structure. He was a great architect. But in that place, he says it's all going to be torn down, and this is what's going to happen. And the Antichrist is going to come. A false Christ is going to come, and he's going to want power. He's going to want fame. He's going to want notoriety. He's going to want adoration. He's going to want worship. And as he does that, God is going to pour out his wrath, and this place is going to become desolate. And for them, what an awful thing. This is their life. This is where their families have grown up. This is the place where things have been happy. They've had good memories there. And he says, flee away from it without even looking back. And don't get caught up in what's going on, but get out of town. Oh, the warning that he's telling them that's going to happen so far in the future. And yet, We see that the precursors of those things coming to pass now. We know that his coming is soon. At least we hope his coming is soon. We would love to see him tonight. That would be a wonderful thing to go home. But in the midst, these poor people that are still going to be there. And there's going to be a great salvation that goes on. Many people who have heard the gospel will probably get saved. It talks about many being slain for their belief in who Jesus was. And under the throne, it talks about in Revelation that they're there crying out, Lord, how long before you avenge our blood? And he says, just a little bit longer. Ugh. So we know that many are going to come to faith, whether through prior witnessing, whether through reading, whether through finally believing the things that they've been told, we don't know. But what we do know is that there's going to be many that are going to be saved, and many are going to come through, but many also are going to be martyred for their faith. And it's just, oh, such a hard thing to look at, because you look at your family and you go, how many don't believe in our families? You know, our brothers, our sisters, our moms and dads for some, our kids, grandkids that are growing up in a system that is completely anti-God. How many are not going to come to faith? And how many are going to be here in the midst of this, even after we've told them? And just, oh. And so the Antichrist comes in and he proclaims himself to be God. And Jesus says, when that time comes, and this is so that it will be written down for later generations to read, to hear, so that they will know what's going to happen. We can look at things and say, well, it'll probably never happen in my lifetime. We don't know, because no one knows the day or the hour but the Father. We don't know when it's going to come, but he does. But those that are left, let him that's on the housetop not go down and get anything but go. Let him that is in the field not turn back again for to take up his garment. But woe to them that are with child and to them that give suck in those days, because it's going to be hard to move quick in those days. And you don't want to be a straggler at that time. And pray that your flight be not in the winter, for in those days shall be affliction, such as was not from the beginning of the creation, which God created unto this time, neither shall be. This affliction that's going to be there is going to be the worst that it's ever been. And we always hear that people always want to tell us, well, things have always been hard. Things have always been bad. And that's true. But it hasn't been God's wrath. This is man's wrath being poured out. This is not God's wrath. But in this time period that we're looking at, this is God's wrath being poured out, intensified over what man can do, and just poured out on those that were in unbelief. And God has every right under heaven to bring this to pass on a Christ-rejecting world that didn't want Jesus, that still don't want him. He has every right to pour his judgment out. He's the one that created us. He's the one that made us. He's the one that's given us everything that we need for life and godliness. And we've rejected everything that he wants for us. And so God has every right to pour this out. And yet there's still going to be people who shake their fist at God. And it's your fault, God. And hasn't it always been God's fault? When things are good, it's because we're good. And we did something right. And when things are bad, it's because it's God's fault. It's not been God's fault. It's been man's sin. And God's judgment upon that sin. And so he says, there's going to be affliction, such as not from the beginning of the creation, which God created unto this time. Notice it says that God created it. It didn't evolve into anything. God created it. And except the Lord had shortened those days, no flesh should be saved, but for the elect's sake whom he hath chosen, he has shortened the days. So he shortens the days, he shortens the time frame, and that the grace of God, just to cut back the time that people are going to have to suffer these afflictions, because it could be very long. He could just pour it out year after year after year after year, but instead he shortens it, because he says that if it was lengthened, no man would survive. We'd kill each other, or we'd die from the things that are going to come to pass upon the earth. And there's going to be so many people. Most figure around 2/3 of the people will probably be killed during this time frame. And yet there's going to be some who make it through. It just amazes me. And yet there's still going to be unbelief in the world. And not because Satan's loosed. He's going to be bound up for 1,000-year reign. For 1,000 years, he's going to be down, so people can't say the devil made me do it. No more Flip Wilsons around. None of that stuff is going to come to pass. It's just our own wants, our own desires, our own personalities, our own wickedness. And then if any man shall say to you, so after all of this, he says, if any man comes then and says to you, lo, here is Christ, or lo, he is there, believe him not. For false Christs and false prophets shall rise and shall show signs and wonders to seduce, even if it were possible, even the very elect. But take heed, take careful warning. Behold, I have foretold you all things. Prophecy poured out by Jesus. He was prophet, priest, and king. Not just priest, not just prophet, but king also. And for you and I, we want him as Savior, and the world wants a Savior, but they don't want a Lord. And a lot of people want Jesus to be their Savior, but they don't want him to be Lord over their life. And we need to have both. We need to be saved, but our heart's desire should be that Jesus would rule and reign over us, because he's worthy. Ugh. Take heed. And isn't it interesting? You know, we already went through and said that within the first 100 years, it was documented by some of the Jewish historians that there was about 60 to 70 people who proclaimed themselves to be Christ, the Messiah, in the first 100 years. And look how many have proclaimed that since, that they were the Messiah of the world, that they were the answer. And he says, if any come and say, lo, here is Christ, or lo, he is there, let's get on a plane and go see him, don't believe him. Don't go, because he's not. Because they're false Christ, they're false prophets. They're going to rise up, and he's going to allow them to rise up because he knows people's hearts. And they're going to have power, it says. They're going to be able to show signs and wonders. And it's going to cause people to question what they believe and who they believe in. Can we believe that this one isn't the Christ? Look at these signs that he's been able to do. Look at the wonders that they've been able to do. But it tells us in Scripture that demons are even able to make themselves an angel of light. They can look really good, and they can be shiny and bright. And how many people are looking for angels? Oh my goodness. Everything in the skies are angels flying through, and they're here for our good. The Lord never told us that. We know that there's a heavenly realm all around us, and the things are going on, but there's also a demonic realm around there, and they have power too to show signs and wonders. That's why you have to know the Word and have to have the Word and check everything out with the Word. Be those Bereans that were talked about in the book of Acts, that no matter what Paul proclaimed, and Paul, this great apostle, probably one of the greatest speakers, orators of any of the apostles, said, don't believe me, you check things out. And he said he loved the way the Bereans did it, because he went in and talked to them, and they went back to the Scriptures and checked things out, and then said, okay, we'll follow, because you're basing things on Scripture, and they line up with Scripture. And that's certainly where we need to be, is knowing the Word well enough that we can handle the Word and bring things to pass in that would just prove what's going on is from God. To take God's Word, to believe it for what it is, but not to believe anything out there till we check it with God. There's going to be false prophets. They're going to rise up, and they're going to show signs and wonders. And all they're going to want to do is seduce. And isn't that what the world wants to do now? They want to seduce those believers, so-called believers, into doing things that aren't right. And it sounds good, it looks good, but it's not God. Look at what he's done to the churches just in the last 50 years. And you wonder, you look at Scripture and you see in Ezekiel where the Lord leaves the temple, and finally he's just gone. And yet the people are still going to temple. The people are still going to church, but God's not there anymore. And how many churches are meeting, but God's not there? It's just man's flavor added to something religious, and it just brings emptiness. And how many lives are emptied just because they don't believe in the God of the church? They want church, they want religion, but they don't want the God of the church. Ugh. So he goes on in verse 24, and we see now the second return of Christ. He's going to talk about that a little bit. Hold your place here. Go back to Matthew 24, And we'll just read it from that section and then put it together with this. And that's what's so great about these commentaries from the Bible, for the Bible, is that we can get so much out of it as we look at it. In Matthew chapter 24, starting at verse 27, Matthew 24 is pretty much a parallel with what's going on in Mark here. And it talks about the return of the king. In verse 27, it says, "For as the lightning cometh from the out of the east, and shineth even unto the west, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. For wheresoever the carcass is, there will the eagles be gathered together. Immediately after the tribulation of those days shall the sun be darkened, the moon shall not give her light, and the stars shall fall from heaven." Remember, we read about that in Revelation. Cardi just finished that, and we saw those things taking place. "And the powers of the heavens shall be shaken, and then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven. And then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn, for they shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. And he shall send his angels with a great sound of a trumpet, and they shall gather together his elect from the four winds, from one end of heaven to the other." Every eye is going to see him. Everyone is going to know that Jesus is coming. When Jesus comes for the church, for the rapture of the church, the only ones that are going to know are the ones that are raptured up. The unbelievers are not going to see Jesus. But when he comes the second time to step down on planet Earth in Jerusalem, when he steps down on, in Jerusalem, he's going to split the mountain in half, and the waters are going to pour out. There's going to be a great earthquake, it says, when he steps down in heaven. Can you imagine? How big is that foot? Wow. Just to announce his coming, the king is here. And the neat part about it for you and I is we're going to be with him, riding those white horses. If you don't know how to ride, practice. It's coming, riding behind him. But we aren't going to have to do anything, because he's going to speak a word and the enemy's just going to be desolate before him. The sword of the word of God coming out of his mouth, just destroying everything in front of him. So back in Mark, here, it says this: "But in those days, after the tribulation, the sun shall be darkened, the moon shall not give her light." Remember, those things have come to pass with some of the judgments. "The stars of heaven shall fall." You know, we see shooting stars and we go, ooh and ah. This isn't just one or two stars. These are things just falling all over the place. The poor astrologers that are out there looking at the stars, and all of a sudden all the stars are moved and shaken, and half of them are fallen, and Orion and all the others are just, half the stars are missing and just gone. The devastation that's going to be not just on Earth, but in the atmosphere around Earth. The stars of heaven are going to fall. The powers that are in heaven are going to be shaken. And then they shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds with great power, not just a little power, but great power and glory. They're going to see him because he's going to be so brilliant, that Shekinah glory just pouring out so much that every eye is going to see him. Even though the sun's going to be darkened, the moon's going to be darkened, the stars are going to be falling, the light's not going to be good, they're going to see Jesus coming. They're going to be able to say, uh-oh, we're in trouble now. Lord, I believe you now. Great salvation on that day. And here he comes. "And then shall he send his angels," and they're going to gather his elect from the four winds. They're going to bring him all together in that great worship service that's going to be there. "Now learn a parable." So he finishes with the tribulation period. And he says, because the disciples asked him, they didn't just ask him what's going to happen, but they said, what are the signs of the coming? What are the signs going to be that these things are going to happen? And so now he goes into those questions being answered. And he said, "Now learn a parable of the fig tree." And remember, the fig tree is Israel. As you look through Scripture, as you see the different ways that the Lord describes Israel, sometimes it's a vine, but also the fig tree. The fig tree is just another wording of excuse me, of Israel, when her branch is yet tender and puts forth leaves, just bringing some fruit to bear, you know that summer is near. The leaves precede the fruit. So you know that there's something happening. You know there's something going on. And we look at this and we know that in 1948, May 14th, 1948, Israel went back into the land. And even our president proclaimed that Israel was there. They were a country. They were a sovereign nation. And it wasn't because he wanted to. It was because the Lord, the sovereign Lord, ordained it such that he would proclaim that to be, even though he could have cared less, history tells us. But it was the thing to do. And the fruit of that, it's amazing, but World War II brought that about because the Jews were so badly treated that the world felt bad for them and wanted to give them a nation. But they wouldn't have gotten it unless World War II had happened, because nobody really cared before that. They didn't want Israel around. The Arabs didn't want Israel around. They still don't. But the world was in such a state that they realized the mistreatment of Israel, that it brought them into the land. All things work together for the good for those that are called. Even though it seems hard, even though it looks hard, sometimes we go through the hardest of times to get to the best of times. They're brought into the land in 1948, this fig tree, and they started putting forth leaves. So in like manner, when you shall see these things come to pass, know that it is nigh, even at the doors. It's nigh. It's close. If it was close when Jesus talked about it then, and he said the kingdom of God is at hand as he walked in this earth, how much closer is it now? Oh my goodness. He says, verily I say unto you that this generation shall not pass till all these things be done. And everybody talks about that generation. What is the generation? Is it a 100-year generation? Is it 40 years? Is it a 70-year? What is it? But that word generation can mean age, it can mean generation, or it can mean a nation's time frame. The time frame of a nation. So as you look at it, what it really tells us is we don't have a clue. But what we do know is we trust God's word. If he says it's going to come to pass, we believe that it's going to come to pass. God, even though the generation that we thought, because I thought my kids would never get past 13 before Jesus came back. The youngest one's closing in on 50. I was a little off on my prophecy. I probably should have been stoned. In fact, somebody said they would stone me if I didn't divide the word rightly. I don't know who that was, but hope it's a small stone. I asked for that. But this generation shall not pass till all these things be done. All these things are going to happen. This generation isn't going to go past that time frame because God says so. And boy, then it comes down for you and I. Are we believing God's word, or are we trusting what we're seeing? And we look at all the things that are happening in the world. And even today, South Korea had to scramble because Russia and China's jets flew into their airspace together. Whoa, could it be today when everything breaks loose? We don't know. But of that day and that hour knoweth no man. No, not the angels which are in heaven, neither the Son, but the Father. Dad knows, and Dad is keeping it together. And it's interesting, you look at that and go, why? But as you look at a Jewish wedding, you look at what's happening, because what's going to be going on is that we're the bride of Christ. The marriage is going to go on between us and our Jesus. That wedding feast is going to take place, but Jesus doesn't come back to get his bride until the Father says it's time. In the Jewish custom, when a son proposed to a woman and she accepted, she took that cup and drank from it that he offered her, and then their marriage, not their marriage, but their betrothal was ordained at that moment. He couldn't come and get his bride until the Father said, it's time. And what he would do, he would go home. He would put an addition on his father's house, And when his father saw that it was fit for him to bring his bride home, then he would say, okay, now you can go get your bride. And so then the wedding party would go and they would grab the bride and whew, back for that wedding feast, that 7-day feast. Gee, 7 days, 7 years. Wonder if there's a correlation there somewhere. I think we'll have to work on that. But it would be dad's say-so that would be the time when the son would come get his bride. So for God to say, son, it's time for you to go back to earth, should be no surprise to the Jewish people. It might be a surprise to us that Jesus, you're God in the flesh, but three but one. And we can't put that together. I can't wrap myself around it, but God does. And Jesus obedient to it, just to allow dad to have the say-so. That day, that hour, no one knows but the Father. And so for them, it's no big deal. For us, it's kind of strange and we can't quite put it together. But dad say so. But then he finishes up with this warning. He says, take ye heed. Be careful. Take very good care. Take diligent care. The word there means diligent. And he's going to say this three times in the next five verses. Take heed. Be very diligent in what you're doing. He says, watch and pray. Not just watch, but then pray also. Pray when you get weak and you're watching. Pray when you get discouraged and you're watching. Pray when you get discouraged with the circumstances that are around us that are just beating us down. And it seems like Christianity is getting more and more attacked. We just had that bill passed yesterday that should have never gotten anywhere. And yet the people who said they represent the people evidently don't represent the people. They're representing themselves because they voted for it and passed it. That Defending of Marriage Act has nothing to do with marriage the way that God sees it. It has everything to do with the marriage the way the world sees it. And the world's vision of a marriage is perverted and it's evil. And you know where it's going to end up? That if the church doesn't go along with it, we'll shut the church down. That's going to be the final act of this bill as it comes through. It's going to make the churches either comply or shut down. Be prepared for home churches because we could be there soon. We'll draw half a fish in the sand, and when you come up to the house, you draw the other half and then come in the door, okay? We'll be there. But he says, take heed, take diligent heed, watch and then pray, for you know not when the time is. Because you don't know, you take heed and you watch and you pray. And yet how much of the church is asleep? And how much of the time am I asleep? Not paying attention to the times that are around me, not paying attention to the things that Jesus has told me. Lord, forgive me and help me. For the Son of Man is as a son taking a far journey who left his house and gave authority to his servants and to every man his work and commanded the porter to watch. The one who is going to be over the door, watch. Because remember, Jesus said, I am the door. It's interesting that he uses the word porter there because the porters watch the doors. He said, I'm the door. While I'm gone, I want you to watch the door. I want you to open and close. I want you to keep those things out of your life that you need to keep out. I want you to allow those things in that the Holy Spirit brings to you. But keep the door because what you let in is what you're going to become. And boy, what are we letting in? As we look at the world around us, what have we let in just to America, just within the last 50 years? What have we let in? We've let every ungodly thing in and shut out every good thing. We've taken down the Ten Commandments. We kicked God out of school. Can't pray in school. Praise the Lord. We got a good praise report today, though. School 28. I had a prayer request come through this morning, and the lady said, pray because some of the kids at the school want to start a Bible club, and it's going before the principal and the board today. And I got a text late this afternoon. They approved it, and not only did they approve it, but the principal bought pizza and drinks. There's still a couple out there. They may have to teach what they're being told, but they can encourage what's right, too. Praise the Lord for those godly teachers. Keep praying for them. For the Son of Man is as a man who's taken a far journey. He took off. He went to heaven. He left his house and gave authority to his servants. Who's his servants? You and I. We're his servants. In every man his work. What's his work? To believe on him who he has sent. It tells us that in John 6:29. What is the work that God's given us to do? To believe on him who he has sent. That's not a hard work. All we have to do is believe. It isn't that we have to go out and witness to 6,000 people a day. It isn't that we have to go out and knock on 44,000 doors. It isn't any of that. We need to believe Jesus for who he is. God, help me to believe who you are in all of my life, in every area, every facet, and every man his work. And he commanded the porter to watch. That's you and I. We're to watch and be careful of what we're letting in and what we're bringing in. And then he says, watch again. So twice now he said, watch ye therefore, for you know not when the master of the house cometh, at evening or at midnight or at the cock crowing or in the morning, lest suddenly he find you sleeping. So what is the danger for the Christian, for those that are believers, is that we're going to fall asleep. Maybe not physically, but spiritually, we're going to be slumbering. We're going to be sleeping. And the church has certainly fallen asleep. We are the church of Laodicea. As you look at all those churches in Revelation, they aren't just churches, they're church ages. And we're the age of Laodicea. We think we're rich. We think we got it. They said, little do you know, but you're poor, blind, and naked. We're the church at the end. How close is Jesus to his coming? And not only how close is Jesus to his coming, but how close are we to going home to Jesus? We could go home today. How many times have you had to slam on your brakes in the past few weeks just because somebody isn't looking and slides right in front of you? We don't know when we're going home, but what we do know is we have a God who's waiting for us. Look at Stephen when he was martyred. Remember when Jesus went home to heaven? It says he sat down on the right hand of the Father. But when you see Stephen, and he looks up just before they stoned him, what did he see? He said, I saw Jesus standing in the glory of the Father. Jesus was standing up, ready to receive him. We've got somebody ready to receive us home to heaven. And whether we go by rapture, whether we go by car accident, whether we go by disease, we're all going home. We just don't like the process and how we're going to get there. But we're going home. We've got a future. We've got a hope that goes beyond this world. But he says to the church that's still here, lest coming suddenly he finds you sleeping. Why is it suddenly? He told us hundreds of years before that he was coming. And yet he says, lest he come suddenly and find you sleeping. Because for the church, it's going to be a surprise. You're here? I thought we had more time. Oh. And he says, and what I say unto you, I say unto all, watch. Third time, five verses, he says, watch. You know when God says something once, he means it. When God says something twice within a few verses, you know it's emphatic. When he says it three times in just five verses, you know it's a warning because the church is not going to be watching. Much of the church doesn't even believe in the rapture. Some of the church believes that the rapture's already happened and that Jesus is ruling and reigning on planet Earth right now, which completely boggles my mind because if Jesus is ruling and reigning, it just blows my whole thought of heaven. Because if he's allowing this and he's ruling and reigning with a rod of iron, something's really wrong. And the church is just all over the place. And we're so busy about stuff that we've forgotten the God of the church. You don't have to hold your place. We won't come back. But go to 1 John chapter 3. And we'll finish up there tonight. 1 John chapter 3. It says, behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us. What manner, what beauty of love the Father has given to his church, to his followers, to his servants. What manner of love has God given to us? What's the manner of it? What's the beauty of it? What's the substance of it? that we should be called the sons of God. I think John just sitting here just amazed as he just sees the world and sees his own heart. And he says, boy, I just see the love of the Father coming upon me and that he's calling me his child in almost in awe, in reverence of what God has done. You know, have you ever looked at that and just, Lord, what manner of love have you given to me that you should call me your child? Me, the one who put the nail in your wrist. Me, the one who put the crown of thorns on your head. Me, the one who put the spear in your side. Me, whose sin fell upon your shoulders to bear. And you were separated from the Father because of me. And yet you're going to call me your child. And what did Jesus say in the Gospels? I no longer call you servant, but I call you friend. We're the friend of God. Oh, Lord, I don't deserve it. I know, but my love has made it possible. What manner of love is that, Lord? I don't have that kind of love. I still yell at people to cut me off. I had a guy go by me today. I was going to pick up my granddaughter from school, going down a hill, double yellow line. There was two cars behind me. He passed both of us across the double yellow line going down a hill in a 35. I was only doing 5 over. Okay, it's still speeding. I can't believe how fast he went. But then the Lord got him because it was a student driver, two cars in front of him, that went up the hill on the other side doing 25. Couldn't get by him. But my heart was so rotten. Yeah, get him, Lord. And he goes, get who? Oh, my heart, what manner of love. If I had love for that person, I'd be praying for him. And I'd love him. And say, must be in a hurry. Maybe he needs to get home for his kids. Maybe he needs to get home for his sick wife, his dying mother or father. I don't know. But my love sure isn't like the Father's. He says, John says, behold what manner of love you have for us, Lord, that you would call me your son, your daughter. Therefore the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not. They don't know what to do with us. If we're truly born again, if we're truly walking in the Spirit, the world doesn't know what to do with us. They don't know what to do with these people that love them, even though they're trying to get rid of them and hurt them. They don't know what to do with them. Beloved, now we are the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be. I'm glad this isn't the final product, that there's something better that's going to come. But we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him. Isn't that a great promise? Do you hold on to that? Lord, I know I'm not perfect, but one day you're going to make me perfect. And who's going to do the work? You, because of your goodness and your grace? No, him, because of his love. That's how much he loves you, that he wants to change you into something better. That he wants to change your heart, your mind, your thoughts. When he shall appear, we're going to be like him, for we shall see him as he is. No wonder when we see people in Scripture and we see them appear before God, they fall down. They don't fall backwards. They fall down before him in reverence and worship because they can't believe the holiness. And it just overwhelms them to the point that there's no standing before it. There's a falling down in worship of it. And when's the last time you looked at God in your reading in the morning and just fell down before him in a spiritual sense of just worship because he was worthy? Usually we're so busy trying to get through our yearly reading that we don't take time to worship. But boy, there's sometimes when you worship and you sit and sing and you just close your eyes and you raise your hands and all of a sudden you can't sing anymore. You're just worshiping. And you're just hoping that that moment goes on for a long, long time. You know, Bill and Debbie, please play another verse. Just keep going. Because I don't want this to stop. You're afraid to open your eyes because you're afraid to ruin it. That's when you know God's doing the work. He's changing us. Look at what he's changed us into already. We know there's a lot more to go. But boy, he's changed us so much from what we used to be. But there's still more to go. Keep putting yourself before him and just allowing him to work. Verse 3, this is where I was trying to get to, sorry. And every man that hath this hope in him purifieth himself even as he is pure. every man that has this hope, what hope? That Jesus is going to come get us, and we're going to be like him when he comes to get us. That's why we want to be purified. That's why I want to be pure before you, because you can have nothing that's unholy before you. So if you can't have anything unholy, Lord, purify me, because you're not the one that needs to change. I'm the one that needs to change. So Lord, change my thoughts, change my heart, change my attitudes. Every man that has this hope, and if Jesus is coming soon, how much do we need to be purified? Do we have to be perfect before he can come? No. But boy, wouldn't it be better for you and I if we were pure and holy? What a representation we could be for each other and for our families and for the world out there, that they could see something pure and holy in the flesh. Every man that has this hope in him purifies himself even as he is pure. Oh, Father, we just know, Lord, we see our hearts, we see our own actions, we see our own thoughts, and we realize, Lord, what a work you have before you, that we're this mess that you're trying to straighten out, that you want to straighten out, and we keep hindering that work. And Lord, we know that you're coming soon. You've told us, and we believe it. And Lord, if we truly believe it, we just want to put ourselves before you so that you can purify us, so that you can change us even more. And Father, we don't want to stay in this state. We know it's not good for us. We know it's bad. We know it's evil. We know it's ungodly. And yet we keep holding on to things, Lord. So please break us if you need to. Sanctify us. Set us apart. Set us free, Lord, from these things that hold us. And free us from those things that we might be pure. We thank you for your word. We thank you for the truth of it. We thank you, Lord, for the things that we see. And we thank you, Lord, that you answer the questions that are brought before you. It may not be immediate, but Lord, you always answer the questions. And so we just thank you. We ask that you just help us to be patient as we wait for those answers, Lord, for the things that we have right now, for the whys and the how comes. But Lord, we know that you always do good, and we trust that. So we just look to you for it, Lord, and we just ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.